coming up on BCN today. It's a big day for the Chinook Regional Hospital Foundation as the Care from the Heart Radiothon is now underway. Plus, BC Premier John Horgan speaks out against protesters who blocked BC's legislature. And Canada commits $6.5 million to stop the spread of coronavirus.
Your Canada. Your Southern Alberta. Your stories. From our studios in the heart of Lethbridge, it's BCN Today with Jeanette Roche.
Hello, thanks for joining us on this Thursday. Today is a big day for the Chinook Regional Hospital Foundation. The 11th annual Care from the Heart Radiothon is taking place. It started at 7 a.m. and will run right through till 6 o'clock this evening in the hospital atrium. Jason Vanderhook, the executive director of the Chinook Regional Hospital Foundation, is expecting a big turnout.
So we're really excited. It's one of the signature events of the Chinook Regional Hospital Foundation is our annual radiothon. So we actually have all six local radio stations in town broadcasting live all day from the Chinook Regional Hospital. We're going to share stories about the impact that donors have had here at Chinook Regional and of course invite people in the community to make a gift so we can continue with that good work. So this year our focus continues to be the mental health area here at Chinook Regional. So we are in about phase three of a redevelopment project in that area of the hospital. So all the money that we raise today will be used to further that project along. Lots and lots of stories of people who have positive experiences when they come here, and it's fun to hear those stories, to know that donations helped to kind of make that happen. So just recently we did a tour of the mental health area, and we've seen the first two phases, and even just the staff there are just like thrilled with the advancements that have been made and how much more comfortable it is and safe it is, and how offering care there is just so much better now that we've been able to improve those areas, and that's all because of donations.
The goal this year is $250,000, with the money going towards mental health initiatives set up through the CRH Foundation. And the hospital will be a busy place today as members of the Alberta Union of Provincial Employees will join their fellow healthcare workers at province-wide rallies organized by the United Nurses of Alberta. AUPE President Guy Smith says that it's a show of solidarity and strength from healthcare workers across the province. He says, quote, "The government is trying to divide Albertans, but we won't let them," end quote. A rally is planned from 11:30 till 1:30 outside of Chinook Regional Hospital. Other rallies are planned today in Edmonton, Calgary, St. Albert, and Red Deer. AUPE is Western Canada's largest union with over 96,000 members, over half of which work in healthcare. Calgary City councillors are trying to make sure an investigation into Councillor Joe Magliocca's expenses continue after the city's integrity commissioner recused himself over a social lunch that cost $163, which was billed to taxpayers. Last summer, the two lunched together and the councillor expensed the meal to his ward budget. Magliocca is already facing an investigation in a separate case for submitting a $330 bar receipt while attending a conference last year. Passenger and freight trains continue to sit idle in parts of the country as protests against the Coastal GasLink pipeline in northern BC continue. Demonstrators supporting the hereditary chiefs of the Wet'suwet'en First Nation are blocking rail lines near Belleville, Ontario, and New Hazleton, BC. The blockades went up after the RCMP enforced a court injunction last week against the hereditary chiefs who had been blocking the construction of the pipeline. BC Premier John Horgan says police are walking a fine line between enforcing the law and protecting the rights of people to protest. Horgan also says that he was taken aback and left despondent by anti-pipeline protests that saw hundreds of people block entrances to the legislature. Horgan admits that he supports free speech and the right to protest, but government employees and politicians trying to get inside the legislature should not have to face a gauntlet of people hurling abuse and blocking their way to work. Protesters supporting hereditary Wet'suwet'en chiefs who oppose the natural gas pipeline across their territory left the legislature Tuesday night after spending several days camped on the front steps.
Yesterday was a day when people were denied access to their workplace, not because of their political views, but because they were seen as symbols of government. That's unacceptable. It was unacceptable to me, and I know it's unacceptable to the vast majority of British Columbians. Peaceful demonstration is fundamental to our success as a democracy. But to have a group of people say to others, you are illegitimate, you are not allowed in here, you are somehow a sellout to the values of Canadians is just plain wrong.
And Prime Minister Justin Trudeau weighed in on the protests over the pipeline project, saying while the federal government respects the right to peaceful protest, the rule of law must be respected. Trudeau made the comments Wednesday in the Senegalese capital of Dakar, where he is wrapping up a visit to Africa.
We recognize the important democratic right, and we will always defend it, of peaceful protest. This is an important part of our democracy in Canada. But we're also a country of the rule of law, and we need to make sure those laws are respected. That is why I am encouraging all parties to dialogue to resolve this as quickly as possible.
And earlier this week, Alberta Premier Jason Kenney said that he's concerned blockades in support of First Nations opponents to the Northern BC pipeline are a dress rehearsal for future project opposition. He says the protests aren't about Indigenous rights because 20 elected First Nations band councils along the pipeline route support the project.
It's no secret that the same groups have been planning. I think this is a dress rehearsal for illegal protests on pretty much any major project. But let me just point out, again, the hypocrisy of all of this. The Coastal GasLink project is designed to take Canadian natural gas to our West Coast, export it to developing countries like China, to help accelerate their conversion from high-emitting thermal coal to radically lower emissions from natural gas. We're always told we should have policy that's based on evidence. Well, the evidence is this. The single greatest thing that Canada could do to reduce global greenhouse gas emissions and to address the climate issues would be massively to increase our exports of LNG. Right now we have virtually none.
Canadian researchers were among more than 300 scientists attending a World Health Organization meeting in Geneva to map out a plan of attack against the new coronavirus. Canada is committing $6.5 million towards research to stop the spread of the virus, which has now infected more than 60,000 people globally. The Canadian Institutes for Health Research and several other Canadian research bodies will hand out research grants for science on the outbreak and expect more money to come as they continue negotiations with the federal government. It was a tearful reunion after a six-week ordeal stretching from China to California. Wednesday, Esther Tabika was reunited with her family for the first time since she and her 15-year-old daughter had to be quarantined for 2 weeks in the U.S.
I have been in China. The famous place, Wuhan, and the last 2 weeks was under quarantine, and I was just released yesterday.
We're happy, and of course, it's not sad. We cry probably out of joy. I don't think it's because we're too sad, and that's what's going through, and I'm happy we're reunited. Hopefully, nothing's going to separate us again.
You okay? You okay, Papa?
I think the government has been very accommodating and very generous, and I think this is very costly to contain so many people. We're talking about roughly 200 people in there for 2 weeks. I registered all our information on the government website, the U.S. government website, it's called STEP, so that in hopes that if there is, there were evacuation plan, we would have been the first ones to be notified, and that's what happened. So we thank God we got on the flight and we came back.
When it comes to mental health, it can be hard to get a conversation started and even harder to keep that conversation going. The Canadian Mental Health Association in Lethbridge launched a course that will help start that important conversation.
We launched what's known as Recovery College Lethbridge. So this is a project that's been launched in sites across Alberta. So recovery colleges are set up in Calgary, Edmonton, Lethbridge, Red Deer, Wood Buffalo, to try and provide people within our community resources and skill development in a variety of course materials. So we don't deal with mental health diagnosis. We don't deal with specific groups for specific diagnosis or specific issues. Instead, we focus on giving people the social skills needed to overcome whatever mental health challenges, struggles they might have, or just give them life skills in general. We think it's really important to do recovery college courses for people who are in different parts of their recovery journey with mental health issues, simply because a lot of people need these skills to thrive in everyday living. And these are sometimes skills that us as humans might have naturally, but maybe we've never been taught how to have a decent conversation, how to put up boundaries in our friendships, and those sort of things that really help us take care of ourselves and can help avoid further mental health issues down the line.
For more information on Recovery College, visit the Canadian Mental Health Association website. A special mental health certification event is taking place at Exhibition Park. The event is looking to help people who have been struggling with mental health, and the facilitators are looking to shed light into awareness and support that's available.
With awareness of mental health becoming much more prevalent in today's society, the opportunity for Exhibition Park to be part of this event and host it here at the site was absolutely important to us, specifically as this ties directly to the agriculture industry. We want to make sure we can give back to that community as much as we possibly can. Availability for 25 people over the two-day course, and we actually oversubscribed this event, sold it out within the first 2 weeks, and we had a waiting list going into the event.
We're starting to learn the basic skills of how to speak to someone that you've potentially identified as having a mental health issue. It's the mental health first aid, and so it's first aid for someone with mental health issues as opposed to a physical ailment. I see people all the time that are affected by mental health, whether it be something as simple as anxiety or stress or depression, and I see it throughout society, and my personal experience with it as well has affected me personally.
The goal of the event is to create a sense of community while also helping to reduce the stigma associated with mental health. And we've got a mix of sun and cloud today in the forecast with some wind gusts up to 60K, but a fairly sunny weekend is ahead of us. Full weather details are coming up right after the break. Stay with us. And here's a look at our weather highlights for today and tomorrow in Lethbridge. Today, sunny day, a lovely, lovely sunny day. 6 degrees is the high, -3 is the low overnight. And into tomorrow, we're going to see a 3-degree day as well. Not too bad with some scattered clouds. Now today, we are going to be seeing some wind gusts up to 60K per hour, but it should be dissipating later on. And then we got some sunny days ahead of us here too. Saturday, sunshine with 6 degrees. We do have some increasing cloudiness on Sunday though, with a high of 2 degrees. And then more sunshine in the forecast for Monday with a high of 2, high of 0 on Tuesday, and climbing all the way up to 10 degrees for Wednesday. Not too bad, and that's well above the average highs for this time of year. Highs should be about 1 degree, lows should be minus 11. The high temperature on this day was in 1996. It was 13 degrees, and the chilliest day was back in 1978. It was minus 33. Now, the sun rose this morning at 7:46 a.m. and it's going to set at 5:45 p.m. And I'm definitely noticing a difference in the evenings as they are staying lighter, and it's awesome. So looking to the west coast today, we're going to be seeing some showers in Victoria and Vancouver, highs of 8 and 7 degrees in those cities. Minus 1 is the high in Edmonton today, and 4 degrees for Calgary. We could see a chance of flurries in both of those cities. Lots of sunshine across the rest of the prairies today, minus 10 in Saskatoon, minus 14 the high in Regina. We did see an extreme cold warning in effect earlier today for Saskatchewan and Manitoba with wind chill up to minus 45. That should dissipate by this afternoon. Minus 14 is the high today for Winnipeg. And in Toronto, 1 degree is the high with snow. Snow also expected in Ottawa with high of minus 2. Minus 1 is the high today in Montreal. They should see some flurries there as well. Same thing with the rest of Atlantic Canada. Snow all throughout the Maritimes today. 1 degree high in Fredericton. Same thing for Halifax. Zero is the high over in Charlottetown and in St. John's, Newfoundland. Same thing, 0 degrees is their high as they are still under snowfall there. There you go. That is your weather highlights. We're going to take a look at community calendar next.
Here's your Bridge City News community calendar. All are welcome to a Valentine's dance being held Friday, February 14th from 7 to 10 p.m. at the Moose Hall in Lethbridge. Music will be provided by Faye Stevens. Admission is $10 per person. A cash prize of $50 and other door prizes will be given away during the evening. Bring the one you love and dance the night away. Come for a fun evening filled with musical entertainment to the Lethbridge Community Brass Choir's Brass Day Concert, featuring international trumpet soloist and jazz artist Rex Richardson on Saturday, February 29th, beginning at 7 p.m. at College Drive Community Church. Tickets are $15 and free for children under 12. Purchase yours today at CASA or visit lcbs.yapcity.com. For details, go to lcbs.ca. Southern Alberta Men's Ministry is hosting Shine Be the Light Men's Conference on March 20th and 21st at University Drive Alliance Church. Emceeing the conference is our very own BCN's Hal Roberts, with special guest speaker Pastor Lennett Anderson of Emmanuel Baptist Church in Halifax, Nova Scotia. Tickets are $20, $10 for college students. Price includes food, fun, and fellowship. Purchase yours by visiting eventbrite.ca. For more information, call 403-327-4422. And that's your Bridge City News community calendar.
Today's daily life hack is for anyone who's had to walk outside the past few days. Walking around in slushy and wet conditions can really dampen your mood and your shoes. Here's what you do. You find a cheap candle and then rub it over the exterior fabric of the shoes themselves. Now keep rubbing until you have a thick layer of candle wax covering the exterior. Now fire up your hairdryer on the highest setting and blast the shoe until the wax melts into the fabric, forming a clear layer of water protection. Next time your shoes come in contact with water, it will bounce right off. There you go, that has been your daily life hack. And please Facebook us if any of you have tried it and it's actually worked, because I wanna see. Changing gears, there was a scary incident in the NHL Tuesday night during a game between the St. Louis Blues and Anaheim Ducks in California. Blues defenseman Jay Bouwmeester collapsed on the bench during the first period. Various medical staff were called right away. Bouwmeester was taken to hospital on a stretcher. Team doctors said that it was a cardiac incident and a defibrillator was used, but he was alert and awake on the way to the hospital. Pretty scary situation there. Playing a high-tempo game like hockey can be dangerous in many ways. We spoke with the athletic therapist of the Lethbridge Hurricanes, Marty Pelichuk, about how the team protects its players.
Health and safety comes first and foremost. We do preseason screenings with them, with our team docs. And if there is an emergency throughout the year, we have emergency protocols set up through the league, and all of us certified athletic therapists have emergency action plans dependent where we're at. Sport is always, especially in hockey, is contact, and there is severe conditions out there that there can be situations. Earlier this year in the OHL, there was an emergency with a laceration to a femoral artery, and the therapist there did really well. Here in the Western Hockey League, we've had a lot of high-level incidences as well, and thank goodness that, you know, we practice the protocols, we do dry runs with the protocols, and that's what we're trained for. That's what we're here, is for the safety of the players and the personnel involved with the hockey teams.
The Canes are back in action on Valentine's Day as they face off against the Winnipeg Ice at the NMAX Center. Emerging from civil war and famine, South Sudan has become increasingly dependent on its vast oil reserves. But troubling reports of widespread contamination and birth defects have many worried about their children's futures. Alan Breed with the Associated Press reports.
When Ping Mayak Gear was born with a deformed foot, stunted leg, and six fingers on each hand, his parents didn't blame God or nature.
The oil pollution.
The Associated Press has obtained several unreleased reports documenting widespread contamination from South Sudan's growing oil industry. They also detail an alarming spread of birth defects, miscarriages, premature births, and other health problems. South Sudan's main oil regions are dotted with hundreds of open waste pits, the water and soil contaminated with toxic chemicals and heavy metals. Rick Steiner, who consults with the United Nations and others on oil pollution, says the oil companies are taking advantage of a struggling developing country.
It's really a tragedy for the people there and for the environment.
Since gaining its independence in 2011, South Sudan has been racked by famine and civil war. Oil accounts for almost all of its exports and more than 40% of its gross domestic product. In 2018, the government told Chinese-led Dar Petroleum Operating Company, one of the country's two main oil consortiums, to begin a cleanup. Sources tell the AP nothing has been done. Oil Minister Awao Daniel Chuang calls links between the contamination and birth defects premature speculations. The World Health Organization and others say exposure to oil and drilling-related chemicals can be harmful to unborn children.
There's a well-established linkage there.
Neither Dar nor Greater Pioneer Operating Company, the other big oil concern in South Sudan, responded to requests for comment. Greater Pioneer paid to have Ping evaluated and told Gear that genetics were to blame for his son's condition. He doesn't believe it. The parents are still waiting to see the medical reports for themselves. Meanwhile, Ping's mother says the infant cries all night in pain. For now, at least, oil remains a big part of South Sudan's future. Alan Breed, Associated Press.
Thousands of European students took part in a recent six-day evangelism conference. Many were seeking ways to respond to Europe's spiritual hunger. The Revive Europe conference inspired hope that a continent dismissed by many as post-Christian might yet experience a spiritual awakening.
Christian university student movements throughout Europe had spent 2 years preparing to welcome 2020 with Revive Europe as their theme. Some arriving students were amazed to see so many Christian young people in the same place.
My favorite part about Revive Conference is to see how many people from different contexts have the same joy of worshiping Jesus.
Although the focus was Europe, university students and graduates came from a total of 68 countries. An international group of speakers took their audience back to the days of the early church so they could better understand how to share the message of Christ in their universities and in the nations of Europe, which many consider a post-Christian continent.
In the last couple of years, there has been an increase in conferences of any sort where thousands of young people come together. I can speak for Germany. We have a movement called the Holy Spirit Night where in several cities people come together in the thousands, sometimes even in the 10,000s. It's a sign for young people who are hungry for more of God, and we really see this as encouraging signs.
Revive Europe's main focus was personal revival, followed by the need for revival on university campuses and across the continent.
There is hope for Europe because Christ is in you. The question is, are you willing to share this hope with others?
We have been sent into the world to be inwardly strong, outwardly focused, and ablaze with the love of Christ.
Between sessions, attendees explored the artistic expression of students' faith, learned about Christian ministries and mission groups, and shared and prayed with each other. The year-end conference was organized by the International Fellowship of Evangelical Students, which works with student movements in over 170 nations. Victoria Harold Perez for the Global News Alliance.
A recent report says Canadians don't have a lot of confidence that Iran will cooperate in the investigation into the Ukrainian plane, which was shot down, killing 176 people, including 53 Canadians, last month. Toronto journalist Brian Lilly has more on that coming up right after this short break. Stay with us.